Hello everyone, welcome to lesson 58 of our Golang course. Before we start working on Go projects, let us cover some standard lib function types and interfaces to support the building of our projects. In this lesson, we will cover ioReader and ioWriter interfaces and how they are used. So let's begin. First, let us talk about the ioReader interface. The ioReader interface is a simple interface with one method called read. The interface is defined as following, and as you can see, it only has one method read. The first argument to read method is the byte slice, where the data read from the source is stored. The read method returns two values. The first is the number of bytes read from the source, and the second is the error. It takes a slice byte to write data instead of returning a slice, as it is more efficient since it does not have to allocate new slice every time it reads data from the source, but instead can reuse the provided slice. So it's acting like a buffer. The codocs for ioReader interface mention that the caller should always process n bytes returned from the method before considering the error or before performing the error check. Doing so correctly handles the IO errors that happen after reading some bytes from the source. It also allows handling of IOF or end of files, as the method returns a sentinel error, that is io.IOF, to indicate that it has reached the end of data stream. So it is not actually an error, but an indication that we have reached the end of data stream. Now let us look at some common implementations of ioReader. The os.file pointer used to represent the file implements the reader used to read data from the file. Then there's strings.reader. This creates a new reader from the provided string. So it turns your string into a reader interface that can be used in your code. BufferReader implements the read for improved performance and using buffer for reading. Then there is the http.request.body that allows you to supply the request body via readers. Another example is bytes.buffer. It is used for reading in-memory byte buffers. Now let us look at some examples of how we can use the ioReader interface in our code. I'm going to create a function called countAlphabets that will take the reader as an input and return the number of letters or alphabets in the data read from the reader. And if there's error, we return an error. So let's first implement it. As I told you, countAlphabet will take an reader, and then we return int, which is the count of alphabets or an error. Let's initialize count to 0, and then let's create a buffer that we can provide to the reader for reading data. Now I'm going to create a for loop or an infinite for loop to read from the reader. Inside it, I will say n error, calling the read method and providing our buffer to read it. Now, as I told you, the codoc mentioned that you should process the read bytes before considering the error. So we are going to do the same. Here we are ranging through the buffer, and I will only range up till the read bytes, if you remember, and here is the number of bytes returned by read or the number of bytes it has read. So I'm going to range over it and then process it. Here let us add a condition to count the alphabets. So we compared the provided byte with the values for uppercase A and uppercase C, or lowercase a and lowercase c. So if the alphabet satisfies any of this condition, that means we have an alphabet. As such, we increase the count. Now, since we have read the data, let's consider the error. First, we will consider the end of file. So if error is equal to io.endofile, we just return the count and nil for error. But if there's any other error, we will return 0, which is the 0 value for int, and the error. So we are returning the 0 value along with the error. Let's create a file here, headers.txt, and inside I can say hello world. Now what we will do is we will read the file. Since os.file implements the reader, we can provide it to our count alphabet and then get the result from it. Let's first open the file. Provide the file name, which is letters.txt. If error is not equal to nil, we will simply panic. Otherwise, we provide the file to our count alphabet. And if there's error again, we will panic again. Otherwise, we will print the number of letters in the provided data. So, fmt printf letters and the count, and then a new line. Let me import fmt, and there you go. So just to revise, we are reading from the file, then providing the file to count alphabet, which accepts ioReader, and then printing the result. Now let's run our program to verify the results. Go run main.go, and as you can see, 10 is printed to the console, which is correct. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. We don't count the exclamation mark as we are only counting the letters. Now the benefit of using the ioReader interface is that instead of a file, I can only just provide a string. How I can do that is using the strings.reader, which converts our provided string into a reader interface. So let me remove the code to read from the file. Instead, what I can do is r strings.newReader and provide the string hello world and give some extra alphabets. Now I can pass r since it implements the reader interface. We just need to import io. That should make our IDE happy. Now let's run the program and see the output. And as you can see, it correctly calculated the number of letters in the provided string, which is 13. And if I provide any other special characters, it will ignore it. So go run main.go, and as you can see, it's still 13. So as we saw here, having the reader interface makes it really easy to reuse our code with different sources. First we use the file, and then we use a string. We could also use http.response.body since it also satisfies the reader interface. Now let's focus our attention to the io.Writer interface. The io.Writer interface serves the opposite of the io.Reader interface. It is used to write data to a data stream. The interface is just like the ioReader interface and has only one method, which is called write. The write method takes a slice of bytes which is used as a source to write data and returns the number of bytes written and an error if there is any. Here we have the writer interface. As you can see, it only has one method, write, which takes a byte slice and returns the number of bytes written or an error if there is any. If you are implementing the ioWriter interface, then please note that if written bytes are less than the provided bytes or less than the length of the provided byte slice, you should return an error indicating an error state. Also note that since the provided byte slice is used for reading data or is used as source to write data, it should not be modified inside your write method. Now let's look at some common implementations of io.writer. The pointer to os.file also implements the writer interface, which can be used to write to files. Then there is os.stdout, which can be used to write to standard output. Then we have the http.responseWriter, which can be used for writing the response body in return of a HTTP request. The bytes buffer is used for writing in-memory byte buffer. So these are some common examples of entities implementing the io.writer interface. Now let's look at an example for the same. I'm going to remove the code here. Let's close this. Now I'm going to write a function writeString. Our function here takes a string and a writer, which is the destination to write the string to. It returns the number of bytes written to the destination or an error if it encounters any. Now we can just use the write method and provide a byte slice. Here we just typecast the string into a byte, as internally strings are byte data. And if there is an error writing to the destination, we return 0 for the number of bytes written and an error. Otherwise, we return n and nil. Now in our main function, let us create a new file. Here I'm using the os.create function to create a new file writing.txt. If there's an error creating that file, we just panic with the error. Something that I forgot to do in the previous example was to close the file. It is very important to always free up resources, so we will use defer to do that. Next, we write a given string to the file using our writeStrings function. We provide the string and file since it satisfies the io.writer interface. If there's an error, we panic again. If we have written the byte successfully, we print the number of bytes written to the file. Let's save it and run our program to verify the behavior. Go run main.go, and as you can see, Go created a writing.txt file, writing a string to the file. This way, you can use the writer interface to write string. Any entity that satisfies this ioWriter interface can be used here. So, you can also have the response writer from HTTP. Let's now summarize everything we have learned. In this lesson, we looked at both io.Reader and io.Writer interface, which represent the opposite ends of data stream. One is used for reading data, while the other one is used for writing data. The io.Reader allows you to read data from source file, network connections, etc. The io.Writer, on the other hand, allows you to write data to files, network connections, etc. Both these interfaces allow an abstract view of the destination, making your code generic and highly reusable. That's it for the lesson. I hope you enjoyed it. If you have any questions, please post a comment under the video or reach out to our Discord server. Until next time, happy coding!